My name is Gregg Deal. I always like to say this because it's an example of who I am. I am a husband and a father. I am an artist, an activist, and I'm a member of the Pyramid Lake Paiute tribe. The family aspect is really important, and I have to touch on that because I think every artist has something that is a part of their work and a part of their voice that nobody ever sees, nobody ever hears. My family is that. This is my family. My wife and I have been married for 15 years. I was 23, she was 21. We have actually four kids. You only see three here. We have one that is now 6 months old, which is a little bit like treading water and somebody handing you an infant. So it's not making a good case for number five. All of my kids, and this is a big part of my voice, all of my children, my studio's in my house, so they come into my space and they see the work that I do and we have conversations about this stuff. They inform my work, frankly. My oldest is Sage Alexandra Huitzu. All of my kids have indigenous middle names. The next one is Five, that's Phoenix Wita Badunjini, which means bear warrior. I will often call him Bear, so if you follow me on social media, I will always refer to him as Bear or the Bear, because it sounds more official. Maddox is my two-year-old, and then I have Grayson, who is the new addition. These guys are my heart. So there's a couple things I want to get into before I start talking about the artwork. Obviously, the theme is heritage, and I'm in a unique position as an indigenous person, where heritage is at the forefront, of course. But as a modern indigenous person, heritage means something else. It's not just about feathers and headdresses and looking like the stereotypical Indian. That our heritage is also a lot based on politics and social aspects and our interaction with the rest of the world. That there's as much heritage in the political actions of an indigenous person as there is on the, you know, quote unquote stereotypical cultural actions of an indigenous person. But there's a couple of things that I use, a couple of tools that I use in my work that is just vastly important. And one of those things is humor. Humor makes things more approachable. It's really easy to point fingers at somebody and say, you know, kill Whitey. But the, I don't say that, it's horrible. But humor is really an important tool to make things more approachable on some really, really difficult subjects. You'll see it in social media, my social media. I'm on Twitter is the_lame_sauce. And on Instagram, it's just the lame sauce, one word. And so you'll see me post images that are just meant to be funny. I really like Javier Bardem. And when my hair was getting to that length, I thought that was kind of cool. My wife thought it was creepy, but there it is. But the humor isn't just, it's not just in my social media, it's also in my personal life. This is Bear. He's dressed like a federal worker for Halloween. That kid is in it to win it. But I actually coached him so that when he was interacting with people, he would say, I told him, I said, when you talk to people, you have to act exhausted. And so somebody would be like, oh, what are you supposed to be? And he'd say, I'm a federal worker. And he'd like sigh. Or somebody would say, I want to take a picture with you. And he would just sigh and say, okay. But the humor, I mean, it's so important. And the kid, he won like prizes with this costume, of course. So he's in it to win it. That's the Bear. But humor also goes to, it also goes to Indian country as well. I made this meme. If you don't know who this might date me a little bit. This is Graham Greene, who's very famous in Dances with Wolves. So we could probably cut the stereotypical flute music. So I was really struggling with I was really struggling with how I was going to explain to everybody the difficulty of being a modern indigenous person or a modern indigenous artist who has an indigenous voice. And I decided that instead of explaining it, that I would just break down the stereotypes. I've been Indian my whole life. That's a really weird statement, but it's a true statement because Indian identity is in a vacuum and it is only one thing. But my identity is not something that I chose. I didn't choose one day that I was going to be an indigenous person. It was thrust upon me. I have early memories. I didn't grow up on a reservation. I went to an all-white school, but I've still maintained that I've had the Indian experience. The experience was had in pretty much the worst way you can imagine. I have early memories of kids calling me a prairie nigger, calling me a dirty Indian, and that is where you have your identity thrust upon you. That's something that you have to reconcile, that you have to, you essentially have to, it's taken upon you whether you like it or not. And being a victim is a really easy thing to do, and probably something I've done most of, at least half my life. But being empowered by your identity is something that ultimately comes to the forefront. But as an indigenous person in America, being empowered by your identity, taking control of your identity, is an extremely difficult thing to do. I don't think I've ever been more Indian than in this picture right here. I love my mom, but I can't believe she let me leave the house like this. This is horrible. I'm a child of the 90s, too, so. So recently I went to the Library of Congress. Their archives are in Culpeper, Virginia, and I got to view a film. It was about 15, 20 minutes, and it was me and three other people. We were the first people to view this silent film that was created in 1910 called Indian Land Grab. And it was everything you would expect it to be. You had a white person playing the Indian has his land taken away, there's this whole sort of romanticism edge to it. It's by all intents and purposes, you know, a good piece of canonized filmmaking that illustrates the stereotype. So I have a couple screen captures. The Indians that are actually there are actually real Indians. I think we were figuring out where this film company was. I think there's a good chance they're Mohawk or Seneca. Because they're based in New York. But the main character is standing right here. And here he is meeting with some white guys. What really struck me in this is actually not the narration. What struck me is that this stereotype is exactly the same today as it was over 100 years ago. And what does that mean as a modern indigenous person who is trying to assert their identity within their work? And how does that coincide with heritage, the way I view myself, the way my kids view themselves? It's a really much more complex thing than just simply putting on a headdress and saying, I'm an Indian. This is a real Indian, and you can see where the stereotype is kind of coming from. This is there's a whole series of old photographs that fall in line with this and that have essentially set the stage for romanticism. I mean, what is more romantic than this, right? The Great Plains, the noble red man sitting on his horse who's drinking from water. But this is kind of what we've been resorted to. If you don't know who this is, look it up. His name is Iron Eyes Cody. Iron Eyes Cody is the crying Indian. Somebody puts trash on the ground, a single tear runs down his face. Later we found out that he's actually crying because he's Italian and not because he's an Indian. But it's an interesting statement on the stereotype. The way that he looks somehow feeds into the stereotype. Because he looks Indian, then he can play Indian. As we've gotten into the modern age, and this dates me, of course, this is the modern stereotype. Because nothing is more Indian than this guy. The interesting part about this movie is that he found the only white woman in the entire tribe, and he hooked up with her. This could also be a scene from Coachella. But this is really and we're listening to the Dances with Wolves soundtrack, which is just so inspiring. And we can cut it. But again, we're talking about stereotype, and we got to break down these stereotypes, right? And we got to really take a good hard look at them. I mean, everywhere you look, there's stereotypes. And they come from things like this, and then they end up with things like this, and then they end up looking like this. This is a painting that's in Firehouse Subs in Woodbridge. We had a whole conversation about it with them, and they just don't give any Fs. It's supposed to pay homage to their local football team, which is Garfield Indians, apparently. But again, the stereotype, you'll notice what they're wearing. And I find myself often blindsided even when I go into public. This is at a Halloween party. My daughter, my 8-year-old daughter, was about 2 in this picture. And mostly I was mad because his regalia is nicer than mine. That's what they call Indian outfits, regalia, sorry. And so it has been morphed, especially in the digital age where we're using social media, we're starting to see elements of appropriation that are coming out, and you're seeing it in full force, and mostly it's coming in form of the headdress. There's credence and value given to the people that do this, and that's why you can end up on the cover of a magazine. And I think it's safe to say that when anybody thinks of Indian, they usually think of this. Rarely they'll think of this. You know what's really funny about this picture? I had to dress and pose for it. So, I mean, humor and stereotype, I mean, there's a lot of room for play here. I mean, you'll notice that your name tags, I hijacked the name tags. If you were a Native American, what would your Indian name be? I mostly set it up so I could decide who's racist and inappropriate and who isn't. But I am interested in seeing mine. I think mine is smells like mediocrity. So. So I want to talk about art really quick. When I say art, I mean in general terms. I've been I went to school for fine art, so I was trained in painting, but I also doubled up as a graphic designer so I could be practical. Practical graphic designer in DC is kind of an oxymoron. And I worked as a freelancer for a number of years. I worked with mostly nonprofit organizations in Washington, DC. The moment that they said economy is going down, I lost thousands of dollars in contracts in about 3 months. And right out of school, I actually worked for a sign company that was fabricating signs. So I was using graphic design to help fabricate signs, but the owner used to call me Tonto. This is in Manassas. When I left that job, when I ran from that job, I worked at the National Museum of American Indians for its inaugural year. But I worked in an all-Native staff that worked on the floor. It's a really interesting thing being like the token Indians at an Indian museum and the kind of interaction that you have. And that interaction actually feeds into a performance piece that I'm really going to be talking about. But it was really probably the hardest job I've ever had, because people come in and they say, how? People come in and they say, you know, what kind of Indian are you? You don't look Indian. It's like a constant conversation about trying to disvalidate who you are based on what you look like, which is all fed into sort of the romantic nationalist idea of what an indigenous person is based on stereotypes. Say that 10 times really fast. but that voice has informed my work. So anyways, graphic design has played a big part in my work. The last job I had for about 10 months in 2009, and it was for a Native American owned company where most of their contracts were creating publications and collaterals for indigenous populations through government contracts like Indian Health Services and things. And the creative director that worked there was a non-Indian woman. And just before I was laid off because they just didn't have enough work for me, I had a conversation with her where I was supposed to create some indigenous looking work. Graphic work. And I did, and she called me and said, this doesn't look Indian enough. Can you make this look more Indian? Where in the world could you be where something like that could be said and it would be an appropriate statement to make? Instead of actually having a conversation about what I made, because the stuff I made actually was very Indian, but her limited capacity to understand what looks indigenous and what doesn't look indigenous was something that ultimately stifled her ability to even communicate with me. So, art. I'm a visual artist, first and foremost. Graphic design has played a big part in my work. And of course, a little bit of the humor too. You talk to me with your words and I look at you with my feelings. And being able to incorporate some of this stuff into my fine art, the world owes you, or the mission is free for dreamers and losers there. At the time, I was thinking like, you know, those that dream are often losers, considered to be losers, and often losers are considered to be dreamers. Using popular culture as part of my work to also inform sort of the stereotypes. So this Tootsie Roll Pop apparently tastes like romantic nationalism. Using illustrations that I found in old Lone Ranger comics. You'll notice all the Indians in this look exactly the same. But then getting into work, a lot of my work is, you know, uses some street art elements, you know, wheat pasting and stickers and ink and markers and paint and spray paint and just a little bit of everything. And all of it is, you know, it's all part of me. And you know, I've had people say, well, you know, so much based on Indian stuff, it's hard to sell. I actually think that me as an indigenous artist should be able to sell my work as an indigenous artist, whether I, you know, whether you think that that's something that you can connect with or not. As an artist, that's my voice. And that's what, you wouldn't ask somebody who is African American to say, can you make your stuff look a little more white so that I can relate to it more? You want to see something that is going to be the voice of the artist. And that's something that I had a hard time with in the beginning and that I've stuck with once I got a hold of it. But using bits of pop culture like Hiawatha here at the bottom, but making comments about health, you know, McDonald's right near the teepee village, using bits of history that are tied in. No dogs or Indians allowed. Those are real things that existed once in our American history. The juxtaposition between the Indian chief from you know, from Peter Pan, which is about a dog and pony show, with the original dog and pony show of Buffalo Bill's Wild West show, pasted in the back. Adding feathers to something that is not indigenous to make it look decidedly indigenous looking. This is the Kevin Costner honor drum. Indians like this because it means you can beat his face while you sing a song. And of course, using, you know, cartoons again. I love this one because I'm not just a painter, I'm a conceptual artist. 80% of my process is conceptual. And I'm not really good at keeping a sketchbook. I'll keep a sketchbook for some of my graphic design work when I'm trying to block things out the way that it needs to go in. But sitting and thinking about my work and then executing it because I've thought about it so much that I can execute it exactly the way it needs to be executed is a lot of how my process is. This is called vehicular dream catch, which is a comment about appropriation. There's a lot of you are sleeping in your cars because that's a dream catcher hanging from a rearview mirror. So now when you leave here, you're going to see dream catchers hanging from rearview mirrors everywhere. But I have Indian friends that come out and they're like, who are all these people sleeping in their cars? That's dangerous, man, sleeping at the wheel. And street art, of course, I love placing pieces in places that are just simple and provocative and unassuming. And then, of course, this goes back into the graphic design, but I'm starting to get into, well, I did a lot of printmaking in school as well, so screen printing, doing woodcuts, I've got some stuff here that you can see. All of this is about things that I have a lot of love in. I love typography. Typography is one of my favorite things. And being able to incorporate typography into my work is really is something that I love doing. This is a can of colonialism, exterior use only. I have one of these posters up here you can see, but there's actually the danger here. It even says culturally and socially flammable, irritates languages, traditions, and self-worth, may cause death, contains manifest destiny. So all of this comes down to the last American Indian on Earth. Some of you may have heard of this. This may be the first time for some of you. The last American Indian on Earth is a concept or an idea that I've had for probably since college. A lot of it was informed by my interaction with James Luna. You can look him up. James Luna is a performance artist who I won a mentorship with, and I got to go to the Venice Biennale with him. A year before that, I was studying James Luna's work because he's a very Indian voice in his performance work. And in another class, I was studying the Venice Biennale, and then a year later, I was at the Venice Biennale with James Luna, which was pretty incredible. But up to that point, I'd sort of never given any credence to performance art because I always thought it was kind of hokey. But James opened up, and James is my friend, he is my mentor, and he opened up my eyes to the value of performance art, because performance art is basically a live voice, an interactive voice, a live person that's standing in front of you, not a painting that you have to think about and internalize and figure out, but actually something that's standing in front of you that you have to see, that you have to consider, that's in real time. And it's a powerful, powerful tool. I think it's a powerful tool, especially for indigenous artists. So what I essentially do is I dress like the stereotype. Pan-Indian, if you will. What is more pan-Indian than the headdress? The headdress only applies to one or a couple of specific tribes, but it has become the quintessential symbol of Indianism. And so in order for me to play the part of a stereotypical image or a stereotypical Indian, I have to wear the headdress. This is actually the headdress that I wore, made in China. I wanted to make sure that anything I had was either something I made myself or something that was pre-made or pre-bought. So all the beadwork I have on my outfit actually were made in China and came in strips, and I just sewed them onto the outfit that I was wearing. But I had to think about every aspect of this. I didn't want to wear moccasins because they'd get destroyed walking around everywhere with this. But I wanted to make sure that I fell in line with things looking indigenous. This is a pair of Vans that I made that look like a pair of moccasins. And they're very cool looking. And then taking this image, okay, the pan-Indian, the stereotypical image is a relic, right? It doesn't exist anymore because we are the vanishing race. And so you take this relic, this thing that once existed and no longer exists, and what happens if you plop it in the middle of the day? What happens if you mess with people a little bit? Indian jackass, if you will. How are people going to react to that? The reason why I chose this is because I don't think that there is a term that has a more visceral response for white people than the term white guilt. It's meant to be funny, so don't get too sensitive on me. But I have a quote from a book called Seeing Red, Hollywood's Pixeled Skins, about the trickster. Tricksters are often found to be a source of satire, calling on communities to rectify their hypocrisies or making their life miserable for oppressors whose inhumanity make them deserving of retribution, which I think is a great quote that applies to the last American Indian on Earth. This is a video, and the video is going to illustrate my interaction with the general public and some of the interactions that I get, which are pretty inappropriate, but so this is cringeworthy, but it's funny.
Is that a costume, or are you a real Indian?
I am a real Indian.
Yeah, from where?
I'm from out west.
The Native Americans have to stick together. And
yeah.
I hope they're able to, because there aren't that many of them left, you know?
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
You don't look any different.
Than what?
Than any other American.
Yeah. I don't know what to tell you.
What kind of hair do you have?
It's dark.
Is it straight?
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you pure Indian?
I'm half.
No, was there any intermarriage?
Yes, I'm half.
You're half Indian?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, you're half Indian and half what?
Mm-hmm. White.
White. Oh, that.
That's what I said. Do you know they?
So you're not 100%.
No, ma'am.
Are there any 100% left?
Of course. And that people have this relationship, like America as a whole has a relationship with indigenous people that is socially retarded.
Yeah.
And that's important. Yes, ma'am. I gotta face this way because the wind's blowing.
It's okay.
The feathers.
Well, it's fine. Here, let's go this way.
I'm telling you, man, the feathers are going crazy.
That's all right. It's your wind in his hair.
And do you, the half of the family that's Indian, do you relate to better?
It's family. I mean, I suppose I relate to it just as much as I relate to any other family. So it's I'm certain it's no different than your family.
Oh, are you really not?
Of course I am.
What are you? What tribe are you from, sir?
Northern.
I am part Cherokee. I just want you to know that. And I don't go walking around in...
Well, I'm a member of the Pyramid Lake Paiute tribe.
Are you really?
Where my mother was born and... Does that deserve a high five?
Yes, it does. Can I take a picture?
Oh, sure.
I can take a picture with you. Are you serious?
Yeah.
This is the happiest day of my life. Who sent you? Police department?
I'm just out sightseeing.
Secret Service?
Yeah.
FBI?
Indians don't really have a good relationship with FBI or police. So.
Can I? You're part of me. You know, we feel about you the same way that we feel about... We feel about you the same way we feel about Africans in our mother country, that we don't know who they are, but we know that we're a part of them.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what they used to call me when I went to work?
Tell me.
Pocahontas.
Wow.
Not kidding.
Hmm.
How?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what is your I was going to say slave name. No, it's not. I don't, my slave name is Paige.
Hmm.
But that was the name of my British slave owners.
Mm-hmm.
Years ago. They named us Paige. But now what is the name of, what is your tribe name?
It's Gregg.
You know, no.
Yeah.
Running Cloud. Red River, something that I can keep in my heart.
How about Walking Eagle?
Oh, whoa. Is that right? Is that the truth?
Yeah, yeah.
Walking Eagle?
Mm-hmm.
East, man, that is so neat.
Walking Eagle. This is a homage to a indigenous comedian who just recently passed away, Charlie Hill. Walking Eagle is something that I use because it's really easy. It's my go-to name. The only time an eagle walks is when it's too full of shit to fly. There's a couple of really important points in that, though. You'll notice there's the older woman who is questioning my authenticity, that because I'm not 100% that I'm not Native. There's the woman that she was with questioning how I relate to my non-Indians, that there's a separation between being human and being, you know, and being white, I guess. I don't know what she was getting at, because my father's white, my mother is Native, and oddly enough, I love them both, you know, and relating to a human being is relating to a human being, right? I mean, it's this weird separation. The woman at the end was interesting because you'll notice she was very aggressive at first. And she said, "I'm part Cherokee, how dare you?" And the moment that she finds out that I am actually indigenous, she goes from a me to a you, that there's suddenly a separation. And which goes down again, and because a lot of what this is about is identity. And so it goes down to identity and about what makes an indigenous person indigenous. Lots of people say that they are part Cherokee or that they have Indian heritage. There is a big difference, and this has to be said. There is a big difference between having indigenous lineage that you're proud of, and there's nothing wrong with that, and actually belonging to a community of people that you are actively engaged with, that you are actively a part of. Just had to say that. So this whole thing was documented through film and photography. I worked with my wife initially, and after that worked with a photographer locally, Dakota Fine, who helped me with the documentation of this project. The performance piece is me going into public and interacting with the public. And frankly, the performance piece is everybody else. It's not me. It's the way that people interact with me. But the way people interact is really interesting. This guy's wearing a Cleveland Indians hat. He's insistent on pointing to it as he's sitting next to me. And I have to keep in mind, none of these are staged. Like, these are actual people that are interacting with me, which is equally as incredible. What do you do when you see this in the grocery store? The Lincoln Memorial. This was awesome because if you've ever been in the Lincoln Memorial, it's very hush, very quiet. And there's even a sense of reverence when you're in there. And so you can hear people talking. When I walk in, everybody's like, oh my gosh, it's an Indian, it's an Indian. And you can hear like chatter. And everybody's just like enamored with this image, right? Which is based on romanticism. When I take out my iPhone and take a selfie of myself, which is exactly what everybody else is doing, people lose their minds. They don't know how to rectify the old and the new. But that's what this is about. This is about taking that relic, taking that stereotype, and putting it into a position that nobody considers it in. This is an Italian group that were on a tour, and the tour guide speaks English and Italian. And the reason why I put this picture up, before she came up, this little boy who was part of their group kept slapping his mouth, you know, over and over and over again. I never wanted to punch a kid so bad in my life. But part of my reaction is no reaction. I don't react. You know, I just let people say whatever it is that they want to say, which I think any indigenous person would tell you is very difficult to just let slide. But she came up and she started asking questions, where are you from? But when she was talking to me, it was sort of the way that, like, somebody talks to a foreigner or somebody that's deaf. Where are you from? Why are you here? You know, and it just did this whole thing. It's very condescending. And the end of it, she finished it with, well, my people send greetings to your people. That's so nice. And even I'm caught off guard sometimes. I was at the parade for the Cherry Blossoms, and this is a school out of West Virginia, and she's the baton twirler. She was the one who was leading the band, and she was very proud of herself. And I walked up to her in the middle of the parade and walked next to her, and I said, can I get a picture with you? She said, yeah, I took this with my phone. Later, I was horrified to notice that her colors match my color, so it actually looks like we're in cahoots. And so on it goes. This is Chinatown. I actually did this on Columbus Day, by the way. And I'm going into public and just simply being there. Went to New York, Lincoln Memorial, of course. I went inside the Natural History Museum. This guy over here is my favorite. He's just like, it's like the most Wes Anderson image I've ever had taken. But then you have images like this. Like, just think about this for a second. This image is mind-blowing. You have two things that are museumized. You have an Indian that belongs behind the glass, and you've got the buffalo that's stuffed. And so you have a real-life Indian taking a selfie of himself with a modern piece of technology in front of a stuffed buffalo inside the Natural History Museum. But it's about questioning these things. And this is much a part of heritage as, you know, the things that you would expect to be a part of heritage. There's a video of me telling a group of Indian kids in Santa Fe, this is in Santa Fe, that I'm going to go bomb this couple's wedding photos, which I did. So, but then you can have images that play into the stereotype, right? I've been kicked out of Potomac Mills. I'm officially banned from Potomac Mills. I actually did go shopping too. I was like buying stuff there. And they asked me never to come back. Can I point out that there's nothing that undermines your authority more than a Segway? No, I'm sorry. A Segway and a bike helmet. And then even going into Starbucks and them not asking my name to write on the cup, but writing Chief on the side of the cup. This is my favorite image, and especially with everything that's going on right now with border control and everything. It says, not confident about immigration reform. As you can imagine, all of this has garnered some press. I was in the Washington Post, Huffington Post. I've landed in a couple other, smaller publications. And it's interesting to me to see how these publications react to this and how they describe it and how they sort of allow it to exist within the vernacular that is their magazine. And this is online, you can find it. I'm Googleable, which I think is very funny. But if you Google my name, this article will come up and you can read about it. But all of this has sort of gone into art activism. So the identity factor, I ended up on News Channel 8, and on News Channel 8, they started talking to me about, they actually asked me to come to talk about the last American Indian on Earth. What I didn't know, because I don't pay attention, is it was opening game day for the Washington Redskins. And they cornered me. And so they asked me about my project, and then went into the whole name issue. And I knew, I had an idea that it might come up because I asked them, but I had to sit down with my wife and say, listen, if they bring this up, do I say something? Because saying something means that I'm going to have to take a stance, and with how rabid fans often are, could put us in a difficult position. Knowing sports writers like Mike Wise, who writes for the Washington Post, I know he's had death threats. Because he's written about the name change. And so that's a decision that we had to make. So the activism comes in the form of the artwork. It's also come in the form of actually me going on the street and speaking at rallies. I was invited on Totally Biased to discuss, if you haven't seen Totally Biased, it was just recently canceled with Kamau Bell on FXX. I was having a dialogue about these things. So this is the elephant in the room. Only in Washington, D.C. is this the elephant in the room. Is this an honor? They say it's an honor, right? This toilet paper tells me it's probably not. But the conversation that you have about the Washington football team is usually not about what it actually is. The Washington football team, the content of this argument is that it's an offense. It's offensive, yes, but I'm not standing here offended. I'm standing here to tell you that this image is the tip of a very large iceberg that is ultimately about equal rights for indigenous people. And the more that indigenous people are not allowed to talk about this issue in the grander form, not about an offensive word, but about why this even exists in the world that we live in the country that we live in, then there's not going to be any change. But I think what you're looking at is you're looking at the very beginning, the very, very beginning of a civil rights movement for indigenous people to assert the power over their own identity. The only reason why somebody can say that this is an honor and that this is appropriate without giving voice to indigenous people to inform whether or not this is because our identity is not ours. It belongs to American culture. American culture dictates that this is what an Indian looks like, this is how an Indian talks, this is how an Indian dresses, this is how an Indian carries themselves, this is what they think, this is what they believe, they have Indian names, they've got a specific nose, they've got specific hair, they've got all of these different elements that make them Indian. And this isn't about offense, this is about asserting our identity and being able to have our identity as our own. That Indian country, there's 566 tribes in the United States that are federally recognized. There's over 300 different languages. There's over 4 million indigenous people in just America. That doesn't count Canada, and it doesn't count Central or South America. And So you can imagine that there's a lot of diversity in Indian country, that it doesn't look like this. I don't look like that. So art activism is something that I got into, and it actually started with this t-shirt. The Gap released this t-shirt, I guess a year and a half or so ago, and it just says Manifest Destiny. A lot of people were up in arms about it for obvious reasons. If you don't know what Manifest Destiny is, it's essentially a land grab. It's essentially the right that colonialists had to go come in America and take land and to live the American dream. Manifest Destiny is based on the American dream. So you can imagine why some Indians and frankly a lot of people in general were pretty offended by this. And so I created this series of t-shirts. All of these words coincide with Manifest Destiny. American expansionism, Indian removal, forced assimilation, American imperialism, romantic nationalism, and mass genocide. And this went viral. It landed on The Guardian and a bunch of other places. And I didn't mean for that to happen, but I just was very pleased with myself. and so it goes. And it became like a part of my voice and a part of like who I am. And you know, there was a point in my sort of voice finding when I was working as a graphic designer, when I was dealing with some of these things, that I abandoned the Indian voice because I was sick and tired of having to deal with Indians and non-Indians and everything else. And I just decided I'm gonna go and I'm gonna be an artist. And this Indian voice crept up on its own. It came out of me as a part of me, but it also came out after abandonment. That by breaking something down and by letting something go, was I able to allow my natural self, my natural voice to come through and to be a part of my artwork. And so that's where this starts happening. This is a poster I created for the Indian Child Welfare Act, which is an act that was put in place specifically to keep indigenous children from closed adoptions and from boarding schools. If you don't know what boarding schools are, they're basically forced assimilation institutions where kids were forcibly taken from their tribes, from their homes, from their families, placed into schools, and beaten if they spoke their language, had their hair cut, take on a Christian name, wear Western clothes, and essentially had their entire identity stripped from them. So the Indian Child Welfare Act, which didn't, as a note, come out until 1978, was about protecting indigenous children and keeping them connected to their communities. And I like to, again, use humor to sort of illustrate the point. America is responsible for mass genocide of indigenous people. They honor the legacy with grown men tackling each other in tights. And so using street art and using these elements as part of my activism, I mean, I can speak to the issues, but these things, I get to put these up and let them stand on their own. So this is a sticker that I created. I have a bunch of them if you want one. It's a very volatile sticker, and it took me probably about 8 months for me to actually allow this to be associated with my name because it's a really difficult sticker to look at. But this is the point that we're at. All of these words, all of these racial slurs, are deemed as being inappropriate, hence them being crossed out. It doesn't mean they're not being used. It means that in general terms, it's understood that if you say any of these words, you're a certain type of person. But this word is still the only word that you can say out loud without getting into trouble or having any kind of consequence associated with it. So the sticker exists within street art, and that it is, I think, an important part of the grassroots effort to create a dialogue. And that's the most important thing in this. It's not about changing the name. It's about having a dialogue. It's about talking about these things so that we can educate ourselves, so we can share ideas and respect one another as communities and as human beings to understand the context of why this is inappropriate. On the back of the sticker, it explains where the word comes from. The word redskin comes from bounty hunting days, where bounties were placed on indigenous heads and indigenous people were killed and people were paid for killing those people, according to men, women, children, and old people. The only way that you could quantify your killings is through Indian pelts, scalps, genitalia, or literal skinning. That's where the term redskin comes from. And while that term exists in other places, that is ultimately where the term lies. And so you have to really ask yourself, if that's true, then isn't it honor? but I don't want to be too serious. I like to turn it around. You know, an honor is such an important word, and so turnabout's fair play. This is a performance piece that I created and I got my friend to do. This is called the Traditional Washington Redskins Honor Ceremony. And I had an opening, an art opening, where he was there watching a football game, singing songs, clapping along, drinking beer, and being the, you know, playing the part. Because that's what it is, right? But the art, to me, it plays such an important aspect in me being able to say something and to say it right and to say it meaningful and to help create a dialogue. Well, let's put it into context with the Washington football team. American genocide is something that has taken place that is an important aspect of American history, and somehow it's been reconciled through football. The truth is that we don't own our identity, and I know I said that before, but we should be allowed to own our identity. My art is so much about that. It's so much about owning the identity and taking it and appropriating the stereotype so that I can regurgitate it back. And it's empowering because it's a part of who I am and it's a part of where I stand. But if none of this convinces you, perhaps there is something that can convince you. Because a big part of this is going back to the original statement that I made, which is about my family. My kids are part Native. They don't really look it. My first three kids all have basically blonde hair. And I thought I understood genetics, but apparently I don't. But they're still part Native. My daughter, who is inherently aware of her Indianness, we were in Target one day, and there's a whole section, there's like a Washington football team section. And she saw it and she started getting weird and like in a huff and she was kicking and kind of just acting weird. And I finally pulled her aside and I said, what's your deal? And she's like, I don't understand why this is here. It's like they're making fun of us. Why don't they like us? Why do they make us look this way? She's 8 years old. And making sure that our children understand identity and be able to hold on to their identity in the most appropriate way possible is so vastly important because I have to protect my children and I have to help them understand that the world that they live in is not one that hates them or that wants to force them to be something that they are, but the truth is that we do live in that world.